thank you for joining us on today's podcast. I'm happy to have Dr. Yamashita with us today. He will be describing his paper that's in the November issue of Hepatology, entitled Gd-EOB-DTPA-enhanced MRI and Alpha-fetoprotein predict prognosis of early-stage hepatocellular cancer. Now, the Gd-EOB-DTPA is an acronym, and I'll try to pronounce this for you. It's gadolinium ethoxybenzyl diethylene triamine pentaacetic acid study. So, moving forward, we'll use EOB-MRI to describe this. But it's very interesting, Dr. Yamashita. Liver cancer is the fifth most common cause of cancer worldwide, the second most common cause of cancer death in men. This is a major issue. Hepatocellular carcinoma is the major variant of liver cancer that we see. And we do have scoring systems out there. We have scoring systems. We have the BCLC criteria, the classification system. They kind of give us some idea of prognosticating. However, it's not ideal, right? Because we can have patients with small tumors that have variable prognoses over time, and they're not consistent. And you bring up the point in your paper that maybe we should do a better job of phenotyping these small tumors early on. And I think that's the crux of your study. I'd love to have you tell us a little bit more about how you came about with what your study design was, what methods you were using.
Yes, thank you very much. So, at all, we may know that HCC is a very heterogeneous disease in terms of clinical outcome when diagnosed at the same stage and treated equally. The question is why such differences actually come, and our laboratory has focused on the characterization of HCC according to the gene expression pattern. Especially, we notice that the stem maturational status is quite important for the prediction of clinical outcome, even diagnosed at early stage and treated by surgical resection. However, gene expression profiling is really nice, but still far from clinical implementation. That's why we looked for the alternative way to evaluate the stem maturational status. And one way is today I'd like to introduce the Gd-EOB-DTPA enhanced MRI. This reagent is quite unique and introduced in Japan and the United States in 2008. And this reagent actually contains a side chain called itokisbenzyl, EOB. This side chain actually can enable the hepatocytes to uptake the reagent and then secrete it into the bile through the multi drug resistant protein and so on. Uptake was mainly performed by the orange ion transport peptide. So we utilized the gene expression profiling, immunohistochemistry, and a lot of HCC samples to evaluate the characteristics of OATP1B3 expressing HCC. That means showing a hyperintensity at hepatobiliary phase of Gd-EOB enhanced MRI.
So this novel imaging study has been introduced recently, you said in 2008,
yes,
to evaluate hepatic lesions with regard to vascularity and the activity of the organic NN transporter OATP1B3, is that correct?
Yes.
So how did you design your study to look at this?
Yes, so according to the previous data of the Gd-EOB-DTPA-MRI, up to 15% of HCC cases showed hyperintensity at hepatobiliary phase.
So significant uptake.
Yes, and the rest of 85% show the hypointensity, so not uptake. And so we performed the gene expression profiling and identified that uptake of Gd-EOB-DTPA clearly shows the nature of hepatocyte. So they express the organic ion transporter. They also express mature hepatocyte marker. And our transcription factor analysis shows that hepatic nuclear factor for alpha, master regulator of hepatocyte function, was activated in this subject.
So ultimately, you reported that this EOB MRI in combination with alpha-fetoprotein status reflected this stem maturation status of HCC with distinct biology and provided helpful prognostic information. So tell us a little bit about the results. Your top line results from the study, what did you see?
Yes, so first we evaluated the gene expression pattern of the hyper and the hypointense HCC. And hyperintense HCC showed no serum AFP elevation.
So if you had significant uptake, then there was no AFP elevation?
No AFP elevation. But the expression profiling also shows that some hypointense HCC the similar expression pattern that resembles the hyperintense HCC. And when we evaluated the clinical pathological characteristic, actually all these HCC, almost all these HCC, some cases showed lower AFP, generally less than 100 nanograms per ml. So we can now classify HCC according to the MRI image and serum AFP to classify distinct HCC subtypes with distinct nature.
So ultimately, you came up with an HCC classification based on this EOB MRI and serum alpha protein, predicting overall survival. Mm-hmm. And I think you had 70 patients where you showed that in a single center?
Yes, our university hospitals. And in this cohort, actually the BCLC, B and C patients, a little bit advanced patients were included. And this might affect the prognostic value of our criteria. So we decided to evaluate the prognostic value of a classification system using independent multi-center cohort that only included early stage BCLC 0 or A stage HCC.
So you looked at it in a separate cohort. I think there was 109 patients.
That's exactly 109 patient cases.
So just a question. At least in the United States, alpha-fetoprotein doesn't correlate with liver cancer. In maybe about 40% of the cases, AFP is elevated, maybe 60%. Mm-hmm. But there's a significant percentage of HCC where there's no elevation in alpha-fetoprotein.
Yeah.
How would this study, how would this imaging modality work, let's say in a case that has HCC, but the AFP is normal?
Mm-hmm. Yes. So I think the case AFP is of course not ideal for the screening because up to, I think, 60% of HCC cases show AFP. But EOB MRI shows that most of, I believe that including this plastic nodule, most of HCC cases can be diagnosed. So I believe AFP can be used for the prognostic value because they have some, the represent cells expressing stem maturation, stem cell related gene expression patterns. But of course, AFP alone is not ideal. Other markers, currently I think various markers like GRIPCAN3 or DKK1, lots of markers are currently under investigation for the evaluation of the prognostic value of HCC.
So where do we go from here?
Yes, so at least our data suggested that AFP, high HCC, showed a poor prognosis, even diagnosed at early stage and successfully treated by surgery. That means most likely this patient showed micrometastasis and diagnosed at early stage. That means after the treatment, this patient should have some treatment option like adjuvant therapy or something. Of course, we know that no effective adjuvant therapy is currently available, but we should think about this.
So I know, is EOB MRI widely used in Japan?
Yes, almost all power centers use EOB MRI for detection of HCC and dysplastic nodule.
So it'll be interesting to see if we can replicate that same data in the United States. And the tumor biology may be a little bit different and certainly warrants further evaluation.
Yes, I'm not sure the status of the EOB MRI usage in the United States. Also, our study had the limitation because this is all retrospective study. So we need to evaluate its prognostic value really in a prospective way in, for example.
And that's a great point. You know, retrospective kind of gives us an idea that it works. Prospectively, we're really going to need to look at this a little bit more closer
exactly.
And see if the same data is substantiated moving forward.
Yes.
Excellent. Well, I'd like to thank Dr. Yamashita for his time today in explaining this very detailed but novel study looking at a new prognostication model for liver cancer. We look forward to more work from Dr. Yamashita in the future. Thank you for your time.